Today the Ethiopian speakers are local people. So as a remark, we will have a few local speakers in the program, either this semester or next one. And these are all related to either coming back from sabbatical or promotion. So now let's welcome our program organizer.
So I have a tough job. I mean, I apologize, this semester will be a bit heavy on us, but I chose to have to compete with people like Joe and Janos and later. Okay, so in algebraic geometry we care about geometric objects defined by polynomial equations. And let me say a bit about geometry, but algebraic geometry in the beginning, then move to moduli, and then to birational geometry. So the fundamental question in algebraic geometry, first of all, is a classification. Classification, and this means everything from classification, properties, and so on. So this is probably the first question. In dimension one, we are in good shape because basically we understand everything. So the point is that an algebraic curve, everything that I told you, so that's by the way. And this is projective algebraic smooth curve, is the same thing as a Riemann surface, and as such, this is classified by the geosystem. So basically, just to fix my drawing, this would be a degree 4 curve. This is the same thing as a genus 3 Riemann surface. And in dimension 1, we are in very good shape. Starting with dimension 2, okay, we know a lot, but starting with dimension 2, the situation is more complicated.
And are, you just, are you just interested in topological equivalence, or is there also algebraic?
This is the moduli part. So here, I mean, this is a. I mean, the first thing you try to understand kind of like the underlying algebraic geometry. In some sense, is the richest of the geometries, the most rigid one, because it's defined by polynomial equations. So the first step in some sense is to understand a bit about like the topology and kind of lower level geometries, kind of more flexible geometries. So in this situation, topologically there is only one in each genus, and now we discuss about kind of moduli, what's happening when you vary the complex structure or algebraic structure. Okay, so starting with dimension 2 and higher, the situation is much more complicated, and here are some key points. So first of all, there is a controlling gadget. So if you want to do any kind of classification, the thing that comes up over and over again is the canonical class, the determinant of the cotangent pattern. So depending on the canonical class, you have three basic cases, positive, so this is analog to the case, genus greater than 2, this is general time, canonical class 0, this is 1, this is collateral, and the canonical class negative, genus 0, this is the case. These are basically the three main cases in algebraic geometry and actually in other situations. And while there exist intermediate cases, at least conjecturally, everything is built up out of these three cases. The second thing that I want to say is that even if you don't want, if you want to do it in terms of the pure geometric objects we call birational geometry, you really need birational geometry. So let me explain this point in a minute. So the issue is that you have blow-ups. So basically, the blow up is a type of surgery that replaces a satellite next. It replaces it with the projectivization of the normal one. The simplest case, for instance, is when I blow up a point in the two space and I replace the point by P1, this would be the exceptional divisor. And what it means is that this thing here, the exceptional divisor, encodes the, if you want the normal direction to the point, encodes the way you approach the point. So this is the basic operation in algebraic geometry. This is the first thing that you learn. And once you start allowing this, it's clear that you need some minimal model. So you need to classify some sort of minimal model. Because if you don't restrict to something like this, then you start blowing up into everything kind of gets messed up. So first of all, you need minimal model, and even better than the minimal model is the canonical model. So let me write it just very roughly. This means that you assume Kx is net, and this one you assume Kx is animal on the model. This introduces singularities and this introduces loads of things. But the point that I want to emphasize is that you really need to understand what's happening when you do these kind of operations, blow-ups. For surfaces, you are in good shape, but starting with dimension field, the situation is much more complicated because when you do blow-ups and so on, you get into the situation of leaves, and that's much more tricky. And the third point that I want to remark here is that you need pairs. You need to start pairs consisting of X and B. So this is a variety of X. It's a variety of pulsar B. So why is that? So there are at least three reasons why you want to do this. So first of all is an induction argument. So nowadays, the birational geometry and things like that is much simpler in some sense because of people introduce pairs. And once you introduce pairs, the situation becomes much, much more natural in the setup of induction. Because when you try to understand higher dimensional varieties, of course, you slice them and you try to understand them in an inductive method, and then you get into the situation of pairs. Second of all is because we want to understand also open varieties, not compact varieties. Algebraic geometry somehow kind of works. I mean, we essentially have no tool to treat the open varieties except to treat them as pairs. So here I'm considering u as x minus d, and this is roughly the same thing as xd. So you might argue here that I can choose a different compact application and all of that. But let me give some sort of evidence. This is the link, for instance, which says that the cohomology of UXC coefficients is computed by a type of cohomology of the sheaf of differential geometric poles. And the point here is that this does not depend on B. And finally, from the purpose of my talk, the most important thing about considering pairs is that you can interpolate. So basically, once you consider pairs, it's natural to consider pairs with coefficient. And the coefficient will always come between 0 and 1. So once you do this one, by the way, I should have mentioned that the controlling gadget here, the thing that plays the role of Kx, is Kx plus D, which is the C1 of this thing. So then here you have Kx plus alpha D, and that one extreme you get Kx plus D, kind of like the open case, and at the other extreme you get Kx, which is just X. So considering pairs allows you to treat, in some some sense you inform me both the compact and the non-compact case.
Okay, so let's go on. And let's go again.
Well, and maybe I should keep my here. So if I fix a G on G, let's assume it's greater than 2, there is a single topological type for a Riemann surface of G, which looks like this. But then, probably everyone knows here, it goes back to Riemann, that 3G minus 3 complex parameters for the complex structure, for the algebraic structure of this one. So this means that we have a mode like mg, which a priori would be a 3g minus 3 dimensional complex matter. Okay, here people can object this is only logical, but let's not make a fuss out of that. So, kind of, this was Riemann, I don't know, 200 years ago or something. So here, he realized that for curves, for Riemann surfaces, you have complex spaces, which parametrizes the complex structures on a fixed topological space. So furthermore, this turns out to be a quasi-projective algebraic variety. And basically, pretty much, quite generally, it turns out that we have a moduli which parametrizes isomorphic classes of fixed invariant algebraic. And this is quite often a quasi project. So you have a fixed underlying topology and geometry, and then if you vary the algebraic structure, you typically get a moduli, something that parameterizes that, and quite often this is a quasi-projective variety. So let me make a comment about MG and move on to higher dimensions. So first of all, why is MG quasi-projective? So we have the GIPP map. This was basically map for pieces. So what he did was the following. So fix an integer peak. Then you can uniformly embed C by the canonical linear system into a fixed projective space. So I fix the genus, I take a large integer, and I take the corresponding linear system given by the canonical class. I think I embed it here. Then, what Mumford proved is that C is GIP stable. So this means that MG, this is basically the quotient of some U modulo SL and U plus 1, and this U is an open into some Hilbert schema. So here I don't want to define GIP and say too much about GIP. What I want to say here is that the GIP is the way we take quotients in algebraic geometry. And there are various, once you want to take quotients in algebraic geometry, you'll see that you are taking quotients of something by something. You see that the points here fall in three categories. There are the stable points, which is an open subset, and this is where the quotient behaves as you expect. So this is like the naive quotient. So this is good to be stable. Then you have the strictly semi-stable points where there is some collapsing, and then you have the unstable points which are which you have to follow in. But anyway, the upshot is that GIP is the way you take the Gaussian imaginary geometry, and this is quasi-projective to begin, and then this entire thing will be quasi-projective. So the point here that I want to say is that for mu large enough, the stability condition stabilizes. So obviously when I embed the curve in higher and higher projective spaces, and the points, the degeneration will look different, but what is stable and what is unstable remains the same. And as a consequence, this doesn't really depend on the, so this is what we will call asymptotic GIP. The fact that once you go to high enough embedding, it doesn't matter if you change the embedding further. The second point is that kind of independent, or I don't know exactly. So we have a mean bound for which constructs the compactification of energy. So this is energy bar, which is obtained by adding stable curves. Here are the very kind of, this is probably the worst definition, but it's the one that you can write it faster. So a stable curve is C has a dwarf nodal, C is a dwarf nodal, so it only has ordinary nodes, and 7/4 stability condition is that the automorphism of C is fine. Once you do that, you get a compact. So initially, when the imam for it, it was just an algebraic stack. And later, Mumford Knudsen proved by exactly the same method, basically they proved that stable curve is GIP asymptotically stable. So this proved that this is also a projective curve. And now in modern times, we have fancy ways to bypass GIP. to prove the project. But anyway, so the upshot here, so the conclusion, that this energy bar is, let's see. So this is a projective smooth normal crossing compactification and moduli. So this is, okay, I'm kind of lying here a bit, but essentially that's true. So first, it's a projective variety. It's essentially smooth. The boundary of NG into NG bar is not crossing. And furthermore, that boundary parameterizes geometric objects, and those are stable curves. And this is kind of like the ideal. So this is what, I don't know, since the 60s we tried to emulate. With not that much success, so let me just briefly say what's the situation in dimensional algebra. So first, the good news. So the Kolar-Shepard baron and Alex Taylor, they generalized the mean bound form to all things. So not in the Lin Manfort to work somewhere, I have the genus larger than 2, which means general type. So once I have general type for a long general type, then we have this polar shepherd bottom as I said, and the Olympian higher temperature series of this, of course. Second of all, more recently, thanks to the work of different departments, Chen Donaldson and Sun, and their application of their work, we have similar situations. Maybe not quite the same, but there is a good compatibilization also for farms. Now the bad news. So first of all, this satisfies like Murphy's law. So it's as bad as it gets, and this is what we here in 2005 or something. I mean, this is not actually as bad as it sounds, because all it says, so Murphy's law means that this compactification or even the modular space itself in general, I mean, here you have a good compactification. So this is what I say here, you get a projective modular compactification. So you keep something from the idea, so keep the projective and the modular. But everything else kind of goes down the way. So basically smooth is as that singular as it is possible. But what it means is that you have to pick your example carefully. But even worse, basically, and this is probably not the Janos talk, there is essentially no example. Okay. So, there is a grand theory, and it works in all dimensions and so on, but basically there is no example, say, of an analog of genus free curves. So, the analog of surfaces of genus free curves. We don't understand.
So you're saying I can't take a product of two genus three curves?
No. So genuine example, it means something that's not coming from curves, from stuff like that. So there are examples, and I'll give an example in a minute, in the work of mine or whatever, some other word. But truly genuine, like...
What would an example be?
I mean, so for instance, quintic surfaces.
Okay.
So quintic surfaces would be the analog of genus free curves of quark curves. So there is no hope, basically, to understand. I mean, the point is that this KSP is a bit of a black box. And this thing brings me to the...
So I'm trying to understand what you're saying. So when you generalize this, do you generalize this in a GIT kind of way?
No.
You say that there is a
in the Manford way.
Say that there is a particular divisor, yeah, on the moduli space.
No. So the generalization is you add X with SLC singularities. So this is the analog of nodal and KX. But you have also, so for curves, you know precisely what it means, what are kind of the degeneration. For surfaces, even if you fix very small invariants, you have no idea what are those degenerations, how many components, or what.
But in the situation where you're looking at something like, you know, quintic surfaces.
Okay, I will answer you. This is the whatever the subject of my talk. This is the biology. Okay, so the idea is to study a moduli space. So instead of studying M bar as the ideal, you study models of it. Models of it. And try to relate to this effect. So here there are two reasons for that one. So first of all, M bar ideal might not exist. So you see that there is a notable exception there, is a Calabi-Yau case. So for example, I discussed, this is the second half of my talk, what can we do about K-free surfaces. So you see, so we are finding the final situation by Chen, Donaldson, and Sun subsequent work. then we are finding the generalized equation. For Calabi-Yau, the equation seems much more complicated. And second, the four M bar KSBA is a black box. So we can try to approximate it with other things. And for example, for quintic surfaces, this was the work of Patricio Canardo, my student. So he tried to approximate KSBA via GLP. And what I've been doing last year, here, is a so-called Griffiths problem. Which involves three things being a self progress operators. And what we are trying to do is to understand KSBA via Hoche theory and the case that we have done a lot of work is a case of H surfaces, which are surfaces with PG equals 2, Q equals 0, H equals 0, and H6 stands for going up. So these are the, in some sense, the simplest possible, the smallest invariants, and we try to understand what's happening then with them. And the idea, as Claude said, was, for instance, in the case of Quindy, you have a readily available model, the GAP form application, and you try to see what's the difference to the N-bar compacted K. And obviously, in all these models, there will be an open subset that's common, so that's why kind of things are birational. So basically, I'm trying to understand the birational geometry of that.
So in the case of quintics, do the added points always correspond to singular hypersurfaces for an equivalence relation, or are there...
No, no, so basically what would happen is that you have some badly singular, worse than semi-locanonical singularities that are GLP stable. And you have to replace those things by SLC singularities. So a typical example, let's say for quadricurves, even for quadricurves, this occurs. So if you take a family of the GAP for quadricurves, you get that the double conic is GAP stable. And of course, what's happening is that you need to blow up the GAP quotient at the point corresponding to that, and you introduce the hyperelliptic curves, and something like this occurs also for quintics. Of course, kind of, the problem for quintics is already a multi-dimensional modular space and stuff like that, and this getting very complicated. I mean, but this will have some nice results. So, I mean, kind of a full, complete understanding is, kind of, for quintics would be kind of too much, but still, there are some nice results nonetheless. Okay, let me briefly mention about the birational geometry, a bit of history, and then go to the new work that I want to work. So let's say history about this birational geometry. So first of all, this occurred in the mid-90s or something. This is the VGAP of Michael Carlos. So, as I said, people knew how to take the quotient in algebraic geometry for a long time due to Hamford. So this is a projective variety, this is a typical setup, and G is a reductive. Now when you say projective variety, you understand that it has a polarization. So actually what you are doing, you are taking the GMP quotient with respect to polarization, which lies in theta phase and incorrect big X, G, so G linearized like one. So now what they did was to see that this is well behaved, very well behaved. This is kind of magic when you really can. So basically what's happening is that you get a point inside. So this would be basically a vector space. You go to the numerical equivalence classes, you get a vector space, you get a point where you get something interesting, and this would be partition chambers. And the main point is that you have word crossings which are easy to understand. And a spectacular application of this one was the Berliner formula. Proof of Fabelius. The idea is basically by doing this, you have an idea. You want to get to an ideal space. You want to get here somewhere. And you understand something here. And then you track about what's happening with the word crossings, and then you get nice application. Okay, so this was in that, and more closely to what I'm doing today is the so-called asset word graphs. So they look at NG bar, and they realize that this has the property that kx plus delta is n, where delta is the discriminant price. Parameterizes singular curves. So then they said, why not find ng canonical, which would correspond to kn canonical. So why don't I define mg alpha product of the intersections of k plus alpha delta? Okay, it doesn't even matter what it is, but this would interpolate from alpha equals 1 to interpolate between mg bar and this mg canonical. So as I said, you can think of mg bar as kind of remembering about mg. But what about if I kind of contract and...
You require alpha to be rational always?
Yeah. So alpha is rational, but the point is that from general NMP, you get this type of behavior similar to the... So a chamber decomposition. So at 1, you know that this is mg bar. And this one is the so-called stable stable. This is 9-11, and let me just explain. So, as alpha goes to 0, you allow more singular curves. So, for instance, the first thing that you do as you move from the stable curves, the first things you do, you allow stable curves. Which means you allow cusps, so cusps are okay, but you don't allow negative tails. So now, remember that in the stable curves, for instance, you don't allow rational tails. Here, the first thing that you do, you remove the locus and elliptic tails. So elliptic curves join to the rest of the curve in one point. And as you go deeper and deeper, you'll allow more complicated singularities, and you remove this type of situation. And what I did, just to talk about what that I did with. So, with Jensen, he was a proposal here, he said that in genus 4, this is the feature, this hazard here, it can be realized as a feature. As a variation of JP functions. So formally they look the same, and kind of conjecturally, maybe you can always conjecture that this NG alpha is coming from a VGFP. What we did was to show that it's small genus. I just wanted to mention the name of Jensen. So I mean, of course, if it were VGFP, that would be good for many counts. Okay, so let's move to new stuff. Any questions so far?
So implicitly, in many of these discussions, you're fixing a divisor. But when you're looking at moduli, I mean, how much do you allow? How do you allow the divisor to vary? Well, for example, you're saying that k plus alpha delta is so.
Delta here is a discriminant divisor. So this is what's coming from the singular. So it's kind of like a natural thing. And then so in some sense, here is. Okay, so here NG bar, if you want, I mean, there is another way to say it. So here we impose the condition that NG bar with delta is one of this. This is what I mean, the minimum for T. But now if you start decreasing delta, you allow this boundary divisor to be more simple. So you allow your compactification not to be really normal crossings, you allow them like that. And that's an interesting problem.
But in general, for this class of moduli problems, we turn on the relative moduli. Yeah. Are you just fixing, in effect, the homology class of the divisor or the homology class?
No. So you have the variety. So what you are doing is, okay, you fix the numerical invariance. So you fix a class of algebraic varieties, but secretly you fix also a polarization. So the canonical polarization is whatever is the one that works best for many reasons, and this is why let me discuss about the K-free situation. This is why the K-free is much more difficult. So for K-3s, you don't have this given polarization, the canonical polarization.
But this approach may not be modular, right?
Yeah. So they conjecture. So here. The approach and this feature, so the approach here, this exists and whatever, so you prove using the finite DCMH that this exists and it makes sense. So the main point is that this is finitely generic in the situation of NG bar. So for any alpha between 0 and 1, of course you have to assume alpha is rational, you get this approach, you get a space. And then they conjecture. And what we show, this was part of why we did that. When if you manage to do it as VGLP, then you have some sort of modular mean of the JNS. So that's part of why we did the VGLP. But let's not.
Rather, here your delta is a divisor on a modular scheme, no?
So I'm looking. So that's the point of my talk. So typically people look at one model. So MG bar. I want to find a projective normal crossing compactification and so on. But now what I'm saying, and this is kind of the point, it might be better to look kind of like to vary the moduli space, to do birational transformation on the moduli space. And let me get to make the case more convincing. So here I was just saying, so here this is a VGLP and maybe so. This is world crossing formulas and stuff like that. So you start with a simple model and you get to something more complicated that you want. This is kind of standard now in mathematics. So this was kind of like a big breakthrough. And then people started looking at NG bar and said that you can do something similar. This exists by whatever general principle in birational geometry. It would be nice to be a VGLP, whatnot, but we only know it. So let's go to. So let me just briefly fix. Okay, a K-free surface. So this is more like K-free. So a K-free surface, I'm requiring the canonical trivial, and again, I'm making the one with minimal words. Definition, so to be simply connected. I'm interested in the moduli space FD, which is the polarized space of these surfaces. So I always need a polarization. I can do a moduli without polarization, but that would be something that I want. So L is ampere, and L squared is D, which would be a positive integral integer. basically any elusive form. This is to find the domain of application. So to start, let me recall like a fundamental theorem. Some people call it already, but it's more than already, is that FD is uniformized by a Calfoord domain. So this moduli space is a quotient of a type 4 domain by an arithmetic group. And this is, by the way, the domain doesn't depend on D, just like 22 depends on the degree. So once you have such a thing, then due to Sakai-Cabrini theorem, you have a projective compactification. You have a canonical but this is very small. No chance. So basically, let me say it once. The moduli space is 19 dimensional, you just add points and curves, so you just add things of one dimension, and that will encode. I mean, it's like a 1-point compactification if you want. So this is too small, but of course, from that you get at least that this is quasi projective and essentially smooth.
What do you mean by modular?
So you would want that the boundary parametrizes something geometric, as in the case of Demi-Mann quad or Polar Shepherd problem, something. But here you just kind of all the degenerations. Let me lie a bit. So all the degenerations don't work. So that's kind of not something that you would want in algebra. Also, this is kind of singular, but kind of what I'm saying a few minutes later will contradict me. But anyway, so people regard this one as too singular. And then we have the toroidal compactification of Manford, but this is too big. And there are many choices involved. And I mean, so this was and is still a big problem. And the reason is that this is this is similar to the case of principally polarized abelian variety that I didn't mention. But for principally polarized abelian varieties, we have a similar story. We have a uniformization. So let me have this. So AG is uniformized by the single upper half space modulo SPG is E. And this has the modular compactification, which is of toroidal type. This is Alexey, Manford, and others. So in the case of abelian varieties, which looks very similar, it's also kind of Calabrian in my sense, we have a nice compactification. In the case of curves, we have a nice compactification. And in some sense, this moduli space is related to both, and so you expect a nice compactification. So there is none so far. Okay, so in the 80s, there was a lot of activity, but it ended up in failure. But this is a failure that kind of is more important than the success, because it led to MMP, KSPA, blockchain. So this is kind of, people try to solve this problem, and out of it grew. For instance, this is the Shepherd Baron. He started looking at compactifications for kilobits. Okay, so this is that. In recent years, what we did was to look at X, H. So we look at moduli of pairs consisting of a K3 and a divisor in the linear system F. This is actually a bundle over FD. So this is a PG bundle over FD, where the D is 50 minus 2. And what's happening, I mean, it looks very similar, but what's happening is that this becomes a log general type. If it becomes of log general type, then you have this case in quantum application. In a recent paper, like 2 or 3 years ago, I completely described it in the big blue case. So when you look at it, in general, in all degrees, in all t, there is a work of cross, happy and q. Very, kind of very deep mathematics involving the symmetry and all of that. So there is some sort of understanding. In a different direction, again, in t2, the problem here is that you are compactifying a different modular space. What Alex said, if you agree to this final section here, so Alex said, found a section, canonical section, if you want, of this bundle. So if you have a canonical section of this bundle, close it up here and get the application. And again, to mention one student, one also here, really have a similar, like say, so we have a compactification, but for pairs. Yes.
Isn't gross Hagen-Keil a partial compactification? There are points they're missing.
Okay. I mean, they are still not able to compare it with mine in degree two. So I mean, there is again.
So it's not a compactification.
Yeah. I mean, it's not. It's only a partial compactification and whatever is kind of a black hole. But that's a different story. Okay, so let me go to the new stuff. So let me report on work with Kirana Kaidi. So we have this, let me drop this degree. The degree is always there. So we have this F bar, which is canonical in some sense. So this is the Satake-Bailey-Borel. It's very good compactification, but it's too strong. What we propose to do is to study the variation of John Jettis. So why would you want to do that? Because you have compactifications with maybe some geometric meaning, mainly the GMP one. So you obtain GIP compactifications, and let me denote them mu, F mu. Secretly, there is also a D here, but let's ignore it. Is I'm taking the K3 surface and I'm embedding it by large power of the polarization in a fixed projective space. And then I'm taking the associated J quotient. So here I'm getting for each integer, for each positive integer, a compactification. This would be a compactification. There are two problems with this. So ideally we would like to have an F infinity, which is the limit of this F mu as mu goes to infinity. And this ideally we want to get it by asymptotic GFP, mainly kind of naive stabilization. So ideally I would like to have an embedding in a big projective space, and at some point it is not to matter what the stability condition will not change. Unfortunately, this is completely false. And this was, this was first noted by Shepard Baron based on Mumford, and recently Schumann showed that this is wrong. I mean, so meaning that the stability condition does not stability. That's stabilize. And second of all, so this would be one thing, and the second of all, we have no idea what this is. No idea. What this is. The only positive result is a Higgs theorem of Donaldson, which says that that S moves in free, then S is asymptotically stable. And this is based on the last man. This is basically the start of the case study. So at least we know something. We know that the smooth K freeze will live in each of these spaces, which is good. So now I have a bold claim and make bold speculation. We are far off on this one. So this F mu actually stabilizes S algebraic. So F infinity would become well defined, and furthermore, this would map to the Bayley Borel compactification, and this would be one. And furthermore, maybe this has a model of meaning in the context of boundary points might be actually this kind of concept is
so this map from F infinity F star, that would be a birational morphism?
Yeah, so this would be actually some sort of maybe small map. So that would be just a small modification on the boundary. So kind of the modular meaning will be beyond algebraic geometry. You'll get this kind of S2 with matrix on them, and that was my first study on semi-transfer.
But so, you said that stability doesn't stabilize. Doesn't it mean that F...
No. So the meaning is that F mu at some point stabilizes as an algebraic space. But each time as you go to mu larger and larger, there will be more and more semi-stable things. So they will collapse. I mean, kind of. The point is that, how to say so, the set of semi-stable objects will be different, but kind of the quotient will be the same. There is no contradiction. And then, so there are some examples of this type.
So when you say this agrees with Klein-Sebius Soyuman, are you saying that the gross hacking Kiel thinks that it's an open type here?
I mean, Gross, Hacking, and Hill, they are looking at pairs, so this would be, I mean, their space would leave over this one as part of the operation.
How about those case reasons with an easing there?
Sorry?
Those case reasons with an easing there?
So I think that in particular, that they would be kind of in the interior, like stable and stuff. Yeah. So the ones with AD singularities, they should be stable. So let's discuss, let me just sketch what's kind of the idea. So actually what we are doing is much more modern, what we can prove is much more modest than we are. So the idea is some sort of, this F star is basically approach of the ring of section. Now, this is a Hodge bundle, and for the purpose of this talk, this is not quite true. You can think this is the canonical class. So the idea is that there is some sort of directed MMP. So you look at lambda plus, let me theta h. So there is some sort of natural divisor. And if you are looking at project these things, then this will cover all natural GIT models. So basically, with Tiran, so this is already, and myself, we simply adapt the Markov-Knudsen computation for NG. So they have a very similar computation for NG, and this is a bit different here. But anyway, and the main point is, so there are two big assumptions in this calculation, two big assumptions in this type of speculation. So the first one is that this ring of sections here, I mean, what we did there is based on Markov and Knudsen, and that's really numerical. So the first speculation, the first big assumption is that whatever you take there is finitely generated. That ring of section is finitely generated. If you know that this is always finitely generated, then you get a nice chamber decomposition, and our computation is that the polarization on the modular space is that L of mu converges to lambda. So you have all the GIT models, you start with GIT one embedded somewhere here, then two embedded and so on. And at some point, because you have this chamber decomposition and you are converging to this lambda class, all of them have to lie in the same chamber. So all of them will be isomorphic. And second assumption is that when you do this kind of GIT asymptotic, you don't introduce new devices. Basically, that you are kind of a four-dimensional condition. This is a GIT condition. So the first assumption, this is the big conjecture. This would be implied by the abundance conjecture in NMP. This is the biggest conjecture in NMP. In our situation, in our example, so we look at quadratic trees. And in that situation, we can bypass one. The second thing is more iffy. And I'm running out of time. So there is an entire story that we understand pretty well in the case of quadratic trees, and I don't have time to say anything meaningful here. But let me just repeat So the idea is to look at these models here. So this H is kind of naturally defined, so it comes from, I'll not go into it, but I can say this is a technical divisor. This means this is the analog of, in particular, this is some sort of Shimura subvariety. It's the more gamma. And the critical beta and the models that you get for them are governed by arithmetic. This is N. This is furthermore. So, not only in some sense, the situation is even better, much better actually, than for Hassett-Hill. You have these spaces. We haven't proved it in general that they are finitely generated, but I think that's just a matter of time. So we proved that in the degree 4 case. But anyway, so these spaces, in principle you have such a behavior. But in the Hassett-Hill program, you know that you have such a behavior, but you have no idea about the critical points and what's happening at those critical points. In this situation that we are studying here, we have precise predictions about the critical points and also what's happening at those critical points based on arithmetic of the situations. That's kind of, in some sense, a better situation.
So here when you're studying polarized K3s, they do have a natural Calabi-Yau metric.
Yeah.
And you can also study these moduli spaces from the point of view of Riemannian geometry.
And yeah.
It seems very hard to relate the kind of Riemannian limits at infinity to the algebraic geometry.
No. So what I'm conjecturing is that this F infinity, so you define it, I mean, so that would be kind of a limit of things that stabilizes variety in algebraic geometry, but if you want to give modular meaning to the boundary points, you have to go to this kind of Riemannian geometry. And there is kind of a good theory developed, I mean, there is not yet, to my knowledge, a good kind of like Riemannian geometry compactification. Is this thing with case series stability and this collapsing behavior. The point is that the algebraic geometry, we take limits kind of in a stupid way, so we stop at the finite point. So kind of this case stability is the correct way to taking limits. And I mean, so there is a good example of this type of behavior is the behavior when you take curves, marked curves, so I don't remember exactly, some sort of configuration like this, so I don't know, genus 4 curves with maybe 3 markings or something like that. The stability condition, I mean, you have this MGM standard compactification. But what's happening if you try to do this kind of asymptotic GIT thing? At some point you'll get the same geometric object here as the limit, but the polarization of this thing will be slightly off. So the polarization should be the canonical to power r to some power on this one, and the canonical to power r maybe the low 2-1 or something. But here you get plus 1 point minus 1. So you get slightly warped. So your GIT polarization, the polarization on this object is slightly warped. So it's what should be plus a point minus a point, which you can only write it as R omega plus 1 over R point. Now if you take kind of like a limit in the usual sense, 1 over R goes to zero, so in the limit you get the MGM thing. So the variety doesn't change, just the polarization on the variety changes, I mean, the one that's stable. And in algebraic geometry, you cannot take the limit in that situation. So what you do in Riemannian geometry, or these things with case stability, you divide and take the limit. So that's.
I mean, is it easier to understand as a prototype? Is there some analogous statement for abelian varieties where, I mean, so there it's very, you know, kind of from a Riemannian point of view, you're just studying flat manifolds.
Okay.
Even if you just imagine, say, what's the infinity for elliptic curves? It looks different from the Riemannian point of view.
The infinity for elliptic curves should be the circle. So the compactification for elliptic curves should be, I mean, it's P1, so you have the affine line and compactify it to P1, and the point of infinity in what I'm saying, I think, should be the circle. So from the perspective of algebraic geometry, you'll allow kind of longer and longer kind of cycles, but kind of when you, so this is kind of an example of what I imagine, I don't know, is really two. But for instance, so in each embedding, you'll get like the limit point will be the cycle with new edges. So you'll never get stabilization. The quotient in all the cases will be P1, but each time as you go higher and higher, you'll get more lines, you'll get the cycle of rational curves. But still, the space stabilizes is P1. And if you want to give a model a meaning, will be this in the sense of case stability, and this is well understood, the case stability limit in this equation is the circle. So you have elliptic curves everywhere, and the circle, and exactly the same thing, I think it holds for case surface. So there will be some compactifications, and actually kind of we can predict something about the structure of these compactifications, so kind of like, I mean, what will be this compactification? And it turns out that it has to be, I mean, modulo the two assumptions here, it has to be a semi-toric compactification. The semi-toric compactification is something between the variable L and the toroidal ones, and whatever, if you read the JC book of Mumford, you see at some point a comment that he was very surprised to see that this toroidal compactification didn't work for cases and apparently the semi-toric ones.
So for the coding piece, what can you describe, like what happens when betas are critical?
Yeah, so in the quartic case, okay, so think about quartic surfaces. There are two kinds of failure, if you think like the analog of hyperelliptic curves for quartics. One is that the quartic can be elliptic A3, and that will match to the double twisted cubic. To the twisted cubic, and you take the tangent available to that one, that would be a quartic surface pretty similar. So that's one type of bad thing, and that would be semi-stable, actually fully stable in the JP world. The other thing is that a quartic surface can degenerate to a double quartic. So it turns out that the problems and all the complications comes from the double quartic, not from the other one, which is more degenerate. The other one is more degenerate. You just blow it up that point once, and you solve the problem. You include the elliptic A3s and so on. The problem with the double quartics is that if you have double quartics, you should have double covers of the quadric cone. And the double covers of the quadric cone are GIT unstable. So you don't really see them. So you need to do a blow up and then further blow ups and so on. So basically all the problems come from the self-intersection of what we call the hyperelliptic divisor, the divisor which parameterizes this kind of things. Right? Double covers of, so K3 surfaces of degree 4. So that's kind of, and everything is, we have precise predictions and we can check it out situation. I mean, in some sense, for people in algebraic geometry, I mean, our result, and I mean, so I'm not even sure that I mentioned the Hengel's name. So our result says something, so, okay. So he studied the degree 2 case. And we studied the cubic form of this. Mayana's paper about this one is kind of similar to the degree case. In that situation, the situation is very simple. Kind of the movable cone of this space is just two extremes. One extreme is the variable L, and the other extreme is the GT. And basically, you do a blow up, you get in the middle, and then you go to. But it turns out that already in degree 4, the move of the cone is much more complicated. And there is a good reason for that. And his paper has whatever significant gaps. But at the same time, this is a simple paper on where he compares the GMP with the label hand. So basically what we do is a refinement both in quantitative terms, so we can predict exactly the variational transformation and also quantitative. So what we said has to be taken off a grain of salt. So actually it normally works in 3 to 4 foot. But anyway, so that was kind of like that paper was written even before Hasek, Hill and so on and had many great ideas and then so kind of we call these things the Hasek, Hill and that all come for gateway surfaces. So it's kind of it combines ideas from both Hasek, Hill and this one. And I mean so the most exciting thing and so this is this thing with the potential of existence of an asymptotic GMP for gateway surfaces, which is something, I mean, so people dismiss this one. And I mean, so this is kind of similar situation in some sense for the general pattern, where Odaka proved that the case stability is essentially the same thing as case stability. So case stability is the correct way to take in asymptotic stability in modern language. This is the same thing as the color.
Okay, that's time to wrap it up.